We are on live. Thank you for your permission for recording this. Basically, today's first session, it is a more general overview on the range of applicability of the field of accelerator and beam physics. But primarily today we are talking about accelerator physics. We'll talk about few of the motivations and the way in which it came about. Next lecture, we'll be doing a detailed history with a timeline and all that, how things evolved and what are the different tracks along which they evolved in the field of accelerators. But today it is more of an overview of how wide-ranging the applications of accelerators are in the world which we know today, technologically, where all accelerators are used. Okay, that is the primary motivation for today. The title is a bit fancy because this is actually an adapted version of a talk which I gave somewhere, and I just adapted it into a proper lecture for this course by adding some extra material which was not there in the popular level thing. Okay, but basically it captures the essence of what we want to look at, that accelerators have been at the driving edge of many different discoveries in many different fields. It is not the perception is that accelerator means particle physics. It is not like that. In fact, we will see today that particle physics is a very small portion of what the technological field that is accelerator-based physics or accelerator-based technology, which is today. Okay. Basically, let us start with a fundamental question. What are particle accelerators? And I would like this session to be interactive, at least to some extent, that if one or two of you can give an answer to this question, what do you understand? What do you mean by particle accelerator? Normally in classroom also, this is what I do in live classroom, that I take inputs and then only we move forward. So please feel free to say what you understand. What do you mean by particle accelerator?
Sir, we accelerate particles to a velocity comparable to the speed of light, and then we collide them to see the results.
Yes, that is what you do if you are a particle physicist. Many parts of what you said are not necessary. For example, you need not collide two beams of particles with each other. The picture shows a picture from a particle physics type of experiment. That's a separate story. But yes, Bushra, you're saying something.
Sir, we use particle accelerators to accelerate the particles at very high speed.
Yes, I would not fully agree with that also. Yes, speed is high compared to some standard, I suppose, but the range of accelerators can go. For example, you can have some accelerators which are as low in energy as energies in few hundreds of electron volt. You can start from there, that low an energy, and it can go up to a range of hundreds of giga electron volt. So the range of energies is extremely wide. Not necessarily some of these speeds are comparable with the speed of light. You have non-relativistic type of particles also in some applications. It depends on the application which you are trying to do. Okay, so it is not. So the first thing is, when you say acceleration, your focus is that speed is very important. That is true. Speed is important, but it is just one parameter when you look at a particle accelerator. Other parameters are that whether you are able to accelerate a large number of particles. If you are able to accelerate to a very high speed, but the number of particles is very small, that doesn't help you in the long run We'll be looking at this quantitatively during the tutorials, but it doesn't help you in the long run, because if you are looking for some kind of rare process to happen, normally you won't see it happen unless you have a large number of particles interacting with each other. So speed is not the only consideration. The other consideration is particle density or particle current. How many number of particles can be accelerated together at a time? And during the course of this semester, we'll see that there are limitations, both practical and fundamental, on the number of particles which can be accelerated together, which means that sometimes you have to trade off between the amount of energy you have available and the number of particles which you will be accelerating. So it is not a one-dimensional concept at all, that it is not only a game of speed. It is a game of speeds and, from a different viewpoint, amount of number of particles or current, beam current, which you can accelerate. And we'll be looking at several of these aspects. But you had the fundamental idea correctly, that you try to somehow increase the energy of the particle and make it move in a particular direction as you desire or require. Okay, that is the basic idea of a particle accelerator. The next question which arises is, why do you want to construct this kind of machine? Why do you want to construct a particle accelerator? And right from the historical origin and present day scenarios, one of the very important criteria for development in accelerators has been that as you go to higher and higher energies, you would end up with shorter and shorter length scales. These two are related through quantum mechanics, through the de Broglie relationship, you know that. So this is a small exercise for all of you to do at your end, and whoever gives me the answer will get some kind of prize. Okay, first answer, correct answer. Prize baad mein dekhenge, but you will get prize definitely. So this is basically, if you have an energy of 1 keV or 1 MeV or 1 GeV, then what is the corresponding de Broglie wavelength if your particle is an electron, and what is the de Broglie wavelength if your particle is a proton? Calculate karo, chalo. See, accelerate, the whole field of accelerator physics and beam physics, it is all about numbers. Okay, one has to have a general feel for what is the typical electric field involved, what is the typical magnetic field involved. And so this whole course, the means there will be less emphasis on derivation as such. We'll be doing a few derivations in class, but the primary idea would be to actually crunch out actual numbers. And there is a usual habit of neglecting the importance associated with numbers if you know the formula. One has to get out of this complacency, because unless that number is right, your knowing the formula does not have any meaning. Okay. So I have my list of answers here for lambda E and lambda P. Lambda E is 3.8 into 10 power minus 2 nanometers, according to mine, which is 38 picometers, like Faraz got. And then this keeps going down as you increase the energy. For an electron, the 1 MeV wavelength is somewhere in 8 into 10 power minus 4 nanometers. And the 1 GeV wavelength is somewhere 1 into 10 power minus 6 nanometers, and so on. You will see a steady decrease as you increase the energy. So if you know the highest energy accelerator which you have, if you plug in its energy into this, you will get the smallest size scale to which you can access, which basically gives you an idea what is the smallest size scale up to which you can study with current day accelerators and current accelerator technology. This has always been one of the primary motivations for higher and higher energy accelerators that you can probe to smaller and smaller length scale. So you can study interactions which are happening at very short length scales. That is how we have such detailed information about the nuclear interaction, that is internucleon interaction. Similarly, that is how we have managed to probe the quark structure of elementary particles like the proton and the neutron. All these are based on solid experimental fact because you are able to accelerate particles to such high energies. Otherwise, it would have been just conjecture and probably would not have developed to that extent. So basically, another idea in accelerators is that you can conduct extremely violent processes in a controlled manner. But what you mean by violent is that extremely high energy processes can happen, but you can control them such that you have outcomes which can be actually related with some physical model or some physical idea. Okay. Which you cannot get by some conventional methods. I mean, you need to accelerate the particle in order to be able to probe such small sizes. That is the basic idea, or that is the basic implication of this statement. Okay. This is a very important idea. This slide is important for two reasons. It introduces the concept of why you want to develop larger and larger accelerators, and it also tells you that you have to be up to the mark with your numerical work, which is the side lesson from this. The next question which arises is how big are accelerators in size? And to answer this question, this is a picture for your reference. This is a small kind of key type of thing which you have, and there is a small object next to it which looks like some kind of transistor, PNP or NPN, that size anyway. And this is an actual technical diagram of the same object. This is a very, very small electron accelerator which acts as a input to an X-ray source. So basically, this is a compact X-ray source which you are looking at. The size is something which is like the tip of your finger types of, that's all, very, very small, less than a centimeter in all directions. But it is basically a around few keV electron accelerator, basically, which is of this size. So this is probably a very, 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 very small accelerator which you can find. Even this is an accelerator because you get a uniform energy electron beam from this, which then produces X-rays. At the other end of the spectrum, you have the Large Hadron Collider in CERN, which is in Switzerland and France. Basically, this is so big that it crosses into two different countries. So one half of this is in a different country and the other part is in a different country. So we'll see a picture of that immediately next. But basically, the size of CERN, the Large Hadron Collider, is basically 27 kilometers in circumference. So you can imagine that the size scale of accelerators means physical size scale, forget the energy scales, but the physical size scale when you want to build an accelerator can be from centimeters to kilometers. We have just seen an example of both on this slide, a very, very tiny accelerator, a compact one, or a very, very large one. And of course, people try to economize this as much as possible. So if you have a large accelerator, it is because you needed a large accelerator for that. It cannot be done with a size smaller than that. Okay. This is another view, as I said, on CERN. And here you can clearly see the border between Switzerland and France. So here is a Swiss flag and this is a French flag. So some part is in France and some part is in Switzerland. It's interesting, to say the least. And also, this is at a depth of somewhere near around 100 to 400 meters below the ground. There are many reasons for that, which we'll come to when we discuss CERN facilities in detail later on during this course. But basically, this is the kind of size scale which you are looking at. So the buildings are at the top, but then you have these maintenance shafts which actually go down to the accelerator tunnel, which is kept well isolated from many, many, many different things. Okay. So you can see that this is a vast, means this ring is 27 kilometers in circumference, which means somewhere something like 8 kilometers in diameter. So if you actually walk across from one end to the other, you are walking like 8 kilometers or so, which is a huge distance. And if you walk one circuit of this, it is like basically running a marathon. And charged particles move something like 10 power 5 kind of revolutions per second. So your protons in the Large Hadron Collider are basically running one marathon every microsecond or so, something like that. Okay. Interesting to just realize this. Okay. So what is the most crucial idea or physics, most crucial physics idea which one would encounter when you want to study an accelerator? Well, basically, you need a method to give energy to the particle. The particle has a charge Q. You want to give energy, which means that you want some force to act on this. The only way we know for a force to act on a charged particle is either subjected to an electric field or subjected to a magnetic field. There is no other way we know how to deliver charge to sorry, force to a charged particle. Okay. So you have to be able to generate electric and magnetic fields in the lab. Electric fields are generated by having a parallel plate kind of arrangement and setting up a potential difference between that. I mean, this is a simplistic picture. Magnetic field can be generated using a current flowing through a wire, which results in an electromagnet. Okay. So the fundamental building blocks of any accelerator will be some kind of accelerating mechanism and some kind of mechanism to generate magnetic field. Okay. It is easy to see that you cannot accelerate the particle in that context, that you cannot increase its total energy using a magnetic field alone. That is because if you look at the equation, the amount of work done on the particle can be obtained by taking a dot product of this equation with dV or d sorry dx. Dx is small amount of displacement. So on the left hand side you will get f bar dot dx bar. On the right hand side you will get q e bar plus v bar cross v bar dot dx bar. But dx, the instantaneous displacement, will always be in the same direction as the velocity v bar. Hence the second term v cross b dot dx becomes zero because both dx and v bar are pointing in the same direction. In a scalar triple product, if two vectors are pointing in the same direction, the result is zero. So basically this v cross b term will go to zero when you take a dot product with dr bar. Okay. So you will find that you can never accelerate a particle using a magnetic field. So the primary role of the magnetic field becomes for guiding the charged particle, and the electric field is the only one responsible for the acceleration. So basically you have to find out how many ways you know of generating electric fields, and it turns out that there are three primary ways to generate, or three primary types of mechanisms to generate electric field. Of course, you can apply a DC field by having a potential difference between two regions in space, or you can generate an AC field and try to bring the particle into the field only when the positive half cycle is going on. That way you will always keep getting acceleration, and this is forms the basis of what we call RF accelerators or AC accelerators basically. And there is a third mechanism to generate electric field, that is if you have a time variation in the magnetic field, then you will automatically generate a electric field in space. This is because of Faraday's law of induction or Faraday-Lenz's law. And therefore, if you have electromagnetic induction, when you change the magnetic field, when you have a time-varying magnetic field, you will get a change in the electric field, and that electric field can be used to accelerate charged particles. This concept is also used very beautifully in a class of accelerators called the betatrons. We'll be looking into that in detail in the coming lectures. But basically, the fundamental idea from this slide is that the only way you have of manipulating a charge particle's motion is through an electric or magnetic field. Out of that, the magnetic field cannot exert any work on the particle, which means that it cannot actually increase its energy. So any increment in energy has to come through electric field only. The role of the magnetic field is important in guiding the particle where you want it to go. But the acceleration, the actual transfer of energy will happen only from the electric field. And there are three different ways in which the electric field can be generated, either through a DC or AC source or through electromagnetic induction. Okay. This is the basic idea in this slide. Whenever you are reviewing this lecture, these slides will also be put up in the Moodle site as well as the recording which we are doing now. Please spend some time with this and understand all these ideas clearly. Okay. Very important ideas. These ideas can save you from making silly mistakes during actually looking at some accelerator working or mechanism or while doing problems. Okay. So please understand these ideas very carefully. Basically, this is all the ideas which you need, which will be recast in different forms throughout the course. There is no new idea apart from these ideas in accelerator and beam physics, actually. I mean, there are several other concepts, but these fundamental ideas are where you base all those concepts on. All right, let us come to the next part of the lecture. We will be talking about several different types of applications. Just to give an overview of the scope, when you say you are studying the ideas associated with a particle accelerator, the applications can be to any of these fields. Okay. So you have got the industrial accelerators. You have got accelerators used in medical for medical purpose for radiotherapy, etc. Ion implantation for materials, surface modification for materials. Accelerators used for radioisotope production. I'll come to this in detail just downstream in this presentation. Particles used for high energy physics, particles used as mass spectrometers, and particles used for generating synchrotron radiation. Sorry, accelerators used for generating synchrotron radiation. So you have got several applications of accelerators, and the numbers in the bracket is a very, very crude estimate of number of such particle accelerators worldwide. I mean, I suppose this is taken from some survey, and I suppose that they must have accounted for a particular size of particle accelerator, etc. Or whether that particular accelerator has been operated as a separate facility. Some criteria would have been put to arrive at these numbers. But these are rough numbers of, or at least the sizes of the different slices in the pie chart gives you a clear idea of the dominance of industrial and material based applications over applications for fundamental physics like high energy physics or synchrotron radiation. The primary use is in industry for research based surface modification or ion implantation and for medical purposes. Okay. These are the different chunks. If we had actually been able to visit some of the accelerator facilities in Bombay, then Samir in IIT Bombay actually has, Samir is an institute, not a person, if you don't know. Yeah. So Samir actually has a division for the medical accelerators. And if we could have visited, it would have been very nice. If we can during this semester, it would be good. Otherwise, I'll try to at least arrange a talk by one of the people from the medical INAC division so that you get a better idea about those things. Okay. So let us look at the industrial applications to start with. Where is the accelerator technology used in industry? A lot of important applications are there. One of them is cross-linking of polymers. So to make extra durable or high strength polymer both in fiber form and in sheet form, cross-linking is a process which is done where the polymer molecules, apart from having fundamental bonds through the molecule, they also have perpendicular bonds with neighboring molecules. This increases the strength and durability of those materials. Sterilization of medical products, medical equipment, where any medical product which is produced, nowadays there are factories which no one handles it by hand. Directly it is fabricated from a sheet and it is irradiated by an electron beam and it is packed. Everything is automatic. So it is really sterile in the true sense when it comes out of the assembly line. When the seal is broken, the material inside is actually completely sterile. Very widely used in semiconductor industry. We'll see an example of that. For surface hardening of materials, this is especially for machine tools like drill bits and spanners and things like that, where the surface properties are more important than the bulk properties. Manufacturing of membranes for various separation processes, etc. Ion beam technology is used quite a lot for this. For X-ray production for industrial uses, for example, for non-destructing testing of different products. Whatever you have, your baggage scanners in airports, for example. Industrial testing of industrial boilers or reactors for flaw detection. All of these things are done. Your ISRO uses X-ray technology a lot to test their rockets before it is launched. Launch hone ke baad phut gaya to nahi chalega na. So they do that. So lot of these are primarily industrial in nature, where the technology is well understood and implemented in a turnkey manner. Means people get ready-made systems and use them for their purpose. This is just an example of a membrane which is generated by ion beam implantation. So highly energetic, like GeV energy ion beams are impinged on this particular material. And you can see that these tracks are created by the ion beam as it travels through the material. So these tracks are basically acts as pores, and this whole material can act as a membrane for separation processes or various applications depending on where you want to apply it. You can see the size scale. This is around 10 microns. So each of these pores is sub-micron in size, means less than 1 micron in size. So you can see that these fine pores can be made, which will help to create this membrane. Another example in semiconductor industry is electron beam. What is it called? Lithography, electron beam lithography, where you can actually focus down an electron beam. Basically, you can focus down any beam down to its wavelength. So you can focus down an electron beam down to its de Broglie wavelength. even at 1 keV you saw that this wavelength is very small. So a few keV beam can be easily used to get resolutions of less than 1 angstrom or up to 1 angstrom, even if your focusing is not good. So you can make extremely small metal contacts on a given surface. Basically, you expose a electron beam resist material, which changes its properties whenever it is exposed to electron beam. So after that, when you do chemical etching, the part which was exposed to the electron beam can be removed. And after that, you deposit a metal film and then you dissolve in another chemical which removes this pink layer, which is the photo or electron beam resist material, so that you are left with a small contact on the semiconductor slab. So you can develop extremely fine point contacts with this kind of method. And this cannot be done by optical means, because the wavelength ranges are in thousands of angstroms, whereas for electron beam you can go down to sub angstrom level also in principle. So this actually helps to revolutionize the large scale manufacture in semiconductor industry. That is what you mean by saying that the chip size is growing smaller and smaller, or number of transistors per chip is increasing, which is called Moore's law. All that is possible because of this kind of technologies. As I said, all these are very well understood technologies. Second major application which we will come to is accelerators for radiotherapy. These are direct applications of accelerator beams for medical purposes, for irradiating particular tissues or particular body parts in order to basically treat the patient, in order to treat that particular body part without affecting the rest of the body parts, basically primarily used for cancer treatment. Instead of traditional gamma ray based sources, where you have to be very careful about the handling of radioactive sources, etc., high energy X-rays from electron beam accelerators are used. This is basically almost everywhere traditional gamma ray based medicine, that is having a radioactive source emitting gamma, intense gamma rays, is virtually stopped and completely replaced by high energy X-rays. Another idea is to have proton beam or ion beam therapy. Just to give you a brief idea about this, the diagram shows the penetration of X-rays into a body tissue. This is depth in centimeters, and this is the amount of dose received at that depth. So you can see that X-rays deposit maximum energy at the skin layer and then gradually less and less as you go deeper. On the other hand, if you have a charge particle beam, the charge particle beam deposits energy very differently. Those of you who have experimental techniques in nuclear physics will come across this during that course as well, that charge particle energy laws and radiation energy laws are very different in nature. So you can actually, suppose the cancer or the tumor is at a depth of, let us say, 25 centimeters, with proton beam or ion beam therapy, you can actually target that such that maximum dose is delivered at the position of the particular tissue which is targeted, and you don't lose out large amount of energy in other layers. Okay, we'll see an example of this soon enough. There are also direct applications of electron beam for skin level, at superficial level kind of treatment. This is an example of a cancer patient with lung cancer, and the central red color dot is basically where the tumor is located. And the left figure shows how you can achieve maximum dose at the site of that particular tumor using X-ray beam therapy or X-ray therapy. And the right side figure is with carbon ion therapy. You can see that both approaches give you large dose at the position of the tumor. But in the case of carbon ion therapy, the peripheral dose is much lesser. You have less amount of dose in the surrounding areas. This is important because it should not happen that while curing one cancer, you induce cancer in some other cell in some other part of the body. I mean, broadly speaking. The damage to surrounding tissues or the collateral damage to tissues is minimized or at least reduced significantly if you use ion beam therapy as an alternative to X-ray therapy. Of course, the trade-off is that there are much less number of ion beam therapy centers. So X-ray therapy is very much there. And X-ray therapy just needs an electron tube. Ion beam therapy needs a whole particle accelerator setup, which is like a whole building next to the irradiation facility. So there are challenges definitely with ion beam therapy, but in the long term, it can be a viable replacement completely for X-ray based therapy, at least for certain types of major tumors and so on. This is just a layout of a ion beam or radiation based treatment facility. You can have a central accelerator, which is shown, or a central ion source, which is shown on the left, top left types. And then there is a ring shaped accelerator, which accelerates the ion beam to large energies. And then that ion beam can then be traveling forward, and it can be bent at various points to different treatment rooms. So there are multiple radiation therapy rooms, and in each of these rooms, you can, not at the same time, but one by one, you can treat different patients. So you can line up patients, that patient A will go to room number 2, patient B after that is scheduled in room number 3, and so on and so forth. So this is a pictorial representation of how a ion beam therapy center can actually work. So you can see that apart from the actual rooms, bulk of the space is taken up by the accelerator itself. On the other hand, for an X-ray beam, the X-ray beam machine will be probably this small. So it will be fitting within one room. So that is another aspect of the whole thing, that an ion beam therapy center is a much larger proposition than just an X-ray treatment facility. For a hospital, for planning, etc., these considerations become important. Another important application of accelerators, as we discussed, is for research based material science, that is materials research, not just industrial application, but actually cutting edge research in actual universities and these things. The first application which we are looking at is basically modification of the surface properties. Many times, properties such as conductivity, etc., are dependent on surface properties. Or if you have a thin film, then basically it is entirely only a surface. So in such cases, one can deposit some different ions into the material, and if you deposit the ion, then the picture looks something like this. The solid is disturbed, but once you heat it and then allow it to cool, the bonds will rearrange themselves, and then these additional implanted particles will become part of the lattice. This is basically, this process is called annealing. This process, the heating followed by cooling, which is done after the ion implantation, that is called annealing. And this can change the surface properties of that particular material. Okay. So both surface and bulk properties, depending on the energy of the ion beam, can be modified. This is another interesting idea, that if the ion beam is very slow ion beam, then actually even before it makes impact with the surface, it already heats up the surface by energizing the electrons, because this is highly charged. There are electrons inside this particular material. Those electrons get attracted, and so the surface properties are changed just because the ion beam is highly charged and moving slowly. So that one can get various different interesting effects on the surface. Like, you can have small hillocks which are formed, or you can have small pits which are formed like this, because some of the materials will get thrown out. Or you can have various types of nanostructures, and these are all being explored right now at the research level. What could be the potential applications of this in things like catalysis, etc., are being explored. But these are basically, accelerator-based surface properties can be changed, and this can have very interesting effects. Right now, these things are actually being explored. For example, there is a university in Austria, TU Vienna, which actually the groups are working there. There are also several groups in Europe working on this. Okay. So these are some of just basic examples of how at the research level, there are still a lot of things people are continuously finding out by bombarding charged particles on different materials and seeing how those materials react. The next application we will look at is radioisotope production, particularly for medical purposes. So apart from direct radiation therapy, there is another important application of radioactive materials in medical field, which is for various types of scans which are done, or diagnostic techniques which are used, where many times if you are having a scan done, normally they ask you to drink certain liquid, because that will then that is called the contrast material, which will allow those parts of your body to stand out in contrast in that scan, so that they can get a clear idea of this. So basically, I will just talk about one particular very important radioisotope in this context. That is the isotope which is called molybdenum 99. Molybdenum 99 is produced in several accelerators worldwide. And as soon as it is produced, it is isolated and it is shipped to hospitals, because molybdenum decays into technetium 99 with a half-life of 66 hours. And technetium 99 is a metastable state which gives out a gamma ray with a lifetime of 6 hours. So basically 66 plus 6, 72. Within 72 hours, this thing has to be used. Otherwise, the all the molybdenum will become ordinary technetium. Your window of opportunity is that if a patient swallows this, then in the next 6 hours, he's going to emit gamma rays, which you can detect with your detector. And just to give an example, this is a standard bone scan for calcium or something like that. And this is a scan with technetium 99. Basically, this scan will not show the bones in contrast. So if there is something wrong along the spinal column of the patient, that can be clearly seen on this scan, which won't be seen on the standard bone scan. So similarly, if there is something to do with the lymph nodes of the patient, that will be clearly seen in this scan compared to the standard bone scan. So this is an application of using this molybdenum 99 isotope for medical purposes. And this guy is produced in an accelerator, because this is a radioactive isotope which has to be produced in the lab. And then as soon as it is produced, it is isolated and it is then packed into boxes and shipped. So for hospitals in any country to be able to have a technetium 99 based scanning technique, you need to have accelerator facilities in that country, preferably in that same state or same region, so that the shipping time, etc., is not delayed, and you actually manage to get this isotope to the hospital on time so that it can be used. For example, some hospitals in India do have this kind of scanning possibility, but they have to import the technetium from abroad, which makes the shelf life of that particular isotope very, very, very short. So that can be resolved if there are more accelerators within the country. This is actually a proposal being made by many groups where they want to have this particular accelerator working, where they can actually produce this.
So when we visited VRC last year, they told that we made that isotope and transferred to Tata Hospital and those things for treating cancers.
Yeah, very, very much possible. They must be doing it. Yeah, but basically we need more and more, and we need them at different places in the country so that this kind of diagnostic technique becomes more widely available, which can be useful for detection of various types of diseases and so on. Okay, very nice. Next, we will try to look at some applications in high energy physics. We'll not spend much time on this, but we'll spend time anyway. The basic idea of high energy particle accelerators is to understand, as we discussed earlier also, to understand the fundamental building blocks, try to see smaller and smaller as minutely as possible. But many of these accelerators also have some multidisciplinary programs that they also have collaborations with other types of research. An example is given here, radioactive waste management. BRC also has an accelerator which is being developed kind of for that, not exactly that, but it can also be used for radioactive waste management. But there are facilities in the US where radioactive waste from their nuclear reactors is taken there for treatment, and the accelerator is used to break down those radioactive waste into other harmless smaller atom isotopes. So that is also an application of high energy accelerators. This is the layout of an accelerator in Europe called FAIR, Facility for Antiproton and Ion Research. And you can see that the entire facility is very, very complex, and it caters to multiple different types of disciplines. This kind of thing is becoming more and more popular, where you have an accelerator facility which caters to multiple disciplines, not just high energy physics. Because since you are anyway accelerating to such high energies, you can use those intermediate stages of acceleration for other types of experiments also. So this is just an example. This is another, this is a radioactive ion beam facility for nuclear waste management, which is in the US. This photograph is actually the Stanford Linear Accelerator Center, SLAC. So this is basically 3.5 kilometers long, one single accelerator. It is the longest single building, actually. Not tallest, longest. Longest single building built in the world as such. And basically the electron beam starts off here and it reaches till here, where the experimental facilities are there. So if you have to repair something, you have to take a jeep from here and go to here and check up what is going on. Anyway, that's SLAC, Stanford Linear Accelerator Center. Another important application of high energy electron beam accelerators is basically synchrotron radiation. Synchrotron radiation, which we'll be dealing with later on in the course in much of detail, but basically synchrotron facilities provide intense sources of electromagnetic radiation, and with a wide spectrum. So the spectrum can range anywhere from, in principle, from radio waves to X-rays. But you don't use them as radio waves, but microwave onwards is usable for actual experiments. One can also get wide spectrum lasers operating in some of the arms of the synchrotron facilities. So one can also get actual laser, meaning highly monochromatic and intense coherent radiation from these synchrotron-based accelerators. this is just an example of a protein structure determination from a experiment performed at a synchrotron facility. Basically, you can isolate different types of proteins and find out their actual structure and how the proteins are folded into particular structures. All this can be elucidated using a synchrotron facility. Basically, all of this is basically X-ray diffraction data. So basically, you generate X-rays from the synchrotron, and since you have a very intense X-ray beam, you can get a very good and clear X-ray diffraction pattern, and then that is interpreted backwards in order to arrive at this protein structure. Very interesting thing. One last application we'll talk about is the application to mass spectrometers, and this in particular, I'll focus on one particular application, that is archaeology based studies. Mass spectrometers are extremely useful in this context. Of course, the same idea can be extended to geology also. The idea is that there is a fixed amount of carbon 14, means carbon 14 to carbon 12 ratio is fixed through the ecosystem. That is, carbon 14 is a part of the regular atmosphere of carbon dioxide. So plants, when they are undergoing photosynthesis, they will absorb this carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. So plants have a regular supply of this carbon 14 isotope. And since the content of carbon 14 isotope in the overall atmosphere is constant, all plants have a fixed ratio of carbon 14 to carbon 12. And therefore, all animals are all biological beings, because ultimately all life depends on plant life. So that gets ingested automatically. So all animals, all plants, all living tissues have a fixed ratio of carbon 12 to carbon 14. However, when that particular tissue dies, okay, then interesting thing happens, that the carbon 14 is a radioactive isotope with a half-life of 6,000 years. So the carbon 14 keeps decaying to form nitrogen. So if you take an old sample, which like you take a tree or an animal which died, let us say 100 years ago, then its ratio of carbon 14 to carbon 12 will be less than what you have in normal human beings. So you can actually take the carbon 14 out from that particular sample and study its ratio to carbon 12. It can immediately give you an indication of what is the age of that particular sample. And this is a very widely used technique in archaeology. And the traditional method of measuring the carbon 14 content is to use a gamma ray detector, which will detect the decay. I think they use a gamma or beta, I don't know. But basically radioactive detector, which will detect the decay. But a more efficient way is to measure the carbon using a mass spectrometer, which will actually use a magnet to separate out the carbon 12 and carbon 14 component. This is basic idea behind our AMS project at our UDP. You have seen the AMS building next to our Tilak Bhavan. So basically that accelerator is for this purpose. And basically, I'll not go into details of this slide, but basically by counting the rings of the trees, you can see that the outermost ring is the old one, and the innermost is the latest one, which is currently alive. So all this wood is dead at different ages. So if you take sample from each of these rings, you will find that their ages are slightly different. And then you can take an older tree and an even older tree, and you can match these tree rings, and you can build up a chronology which goes back to extremely old times. I'll not go into details of this, as I said, but if you are interested, we can always discuss later. But basically, all of this is made possible because of your ability to isolate the carbon 14 isotope. And our machine at AMS machine at the university, it has a capability of detecting even down to few atomoles. That is, basically extremely small number of carbon 14 particles in comparison with carbon 12, and in principle it is capable of going backwards in time to around 60,000 years. Means if a sample is 60,000 years old, you can still detect the age within certain error bars. So that is a capability of the machine at university. Okay. And this can be used to date different samples from different time periods. Just one last idea before we conclude. This is a layout which was planned very, very early on, which I don't think is really brought into actual implementation. But the idea is to have a power fusion-based factory for getting energy. It's a power plant of a type. Okay. So basically, the idea is you have these pellets of helium somehow at cryogenic temperatures, and then you bombard this with ion beams from all sides. So each of these four flower-shaped things at the center is actually a helium pellet, and the accelerator beam is bombarding it from all sides, such that there will be such high pressure from the ion beam bombardment that fusion process will take place spontaneously, or the temperature is raised high enough to cross the fusion barrier and the fusion takes place. And this becomes a self-sustaining facility. So it means you initiate the accelerator, but then it starts powering itself, and then the remaining power can be put on the grid, something like that. This never came to actual application stage because of technological challenges probably. But the basic idea is that such an idea is still a feasible idea. No one knows whether this kind of thing will work out or not with modern day technology, but there could be such a possibility in the future. This is just a idea or concept stage thing, that there could be great revolutions in the energy industry if accelerator based technologies are integrated in a more meaningful manner into the energy scenario. Basically, fossil fuel dependence would be reduced greatly. That is the primary idea. Anyway, this is just a concept sketch, and no one really knows whether this works or this would work. I have not even seen what are the feasibility reports on this. This is very old. This is like a proposal which was there in the 1980s. I don't know what happened to this after that, but anyway, I just thought I'll show this slide. Basically, you can get a very clean energy source through an accelerator-based fusion kind of cycle, if it can be established. That was the idea or concept which I wanted to float here. And of course, we didn't talk about many things, but we will be dealing with many of these things during the course. The last two bullet points which are there, we might deal with it in an indirect manner through seminar topics. But the first three topics we will be looking at in one way or the other during the course. Okay. Yeah, I think this is a good time for me to stop. Okay. And I'll stop the recording as well. But thank you for your attention.